driving school.
Hello and welcome to Oh When the Town. And tonight I'm joined by Batara on my left, Dave on my right.
Hi.
Evening, guys. How are you both?
Good evening.
Yeah, very well. Very well.
So far, so good. Anyway,
it's quite exciting, isn't it?
Well, the football.
Yeah, football's been quite exciting. It's been quite fun.
Yeah, exciting. Blood pressure raising. Yeah, everything else. We all know what's going on, but yeah. It's good to be in the hunt still,
We generally did take our blood pressure during the game, didn't we?
Yeah.
It was very high. I had to leave the room at one point. Yeah, absolutely. It's good.
It was a very good week of football, good weekend of football. It's just nice to get... It's just... When your hope gets the lowest point, after that QPR game, you were like, nah, we're down, it's done. And we got a hole and win. We had a couple of results go our way in the week. And suddenly, it's now looking like... Well, it is in our own hands. We pick up a win against Blackburn, and we are sorted. We are staying up. Get a win.
Mate,
I have to say, you know, a few weeks ago we were, you know, we had despair when, especially when you got thumped 5-0.
Yep.
You know, and then the next week it changes, and then it goes back again, and you're pulling your hair out again. But this week, I feel. There's the hope is there that we're going to do it.
Energised.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. I mean, let's be honest. Yeah. The performances away have been brilliant. The performances at home,
not great.
Not great.
Yeah, that's it. But look, we'll get on to that hopefully Wednesday. Yeah.
Do you know?
Wednesday. Oh, man. Tomorrow or something, please.
Well, let's look at some three-word reviews of the whole game. Cam says, imagine disliking football. Robert says, love my club. Richard said, job not done. Philip says, I'm emotionally shattered. Raz says, control the controllables. James says, it's in our hands. Mark says, game-changing subs. And J-Mo says, Bataro tattoo appointment. And in case you don't know what he's on about, basically Bataro promised a few weeks ago on the podcast, if Nathan Jones keeps us up, he will get a tattoo of him on his chest.
Yeah, beating his chest.
We're holding
his chest.
Yeah. I will try and get it. For Nathan Jones beating my chest, but I don't think that's possible. So,
folks, they should send the designs in for you now.
Yeah, and everyone's helped me out. I guess it costs quite a bit. On that as well.
Totally, though. Imagine disliking football because it's one of those things, isn't it, that you get so involved and you get so frustrated and then so delighted. Mm-hmm. It's such a brilliant thing to be involved in.
I love
my club, Robert, too. That's all good. And Richard, job not done, totally not done.
I think the only negative you can take from Saturday is there wasn't 4,000 Luton fans behind that goal.
Can you imagine what that would have been like? Because we'd have been there.
Oh, yeah.
We'd have totally been there, and it would have been absolute limbs.
It would have been mad.
But it isn't over yet.
I think limbs would have been broken that day as well.
Yeah. I mean, let's take the glory from that game, but it's not finished yet. But the hope has been raised yet again.
It's crazy. We were written off, weren't we, weeks ago? Written off. I mean, I know you like to write us off a little bit early, Chris,
brilliant.
True, isn't it? But anyway, we held on to that, obviously, that belief, and I think maybe, you know, QPR might have been one game too far after that.
I don't want to be negative, but those home games have really shafted us there. We could have been clear of it all. However, we've still got a really good chance of staying up, and we've just got to get the result Wednesday.
The thing is, though, you would have swapped... If someone said to you, them like away games would have won, were the home games, and we'd have got points in the away games, you'd have probably taken that.
If you just reversed our home and away form, massively.
You'd look at that and go, that's not so bad.
We're still on pretty decent form. We're unbeaten now in our path, obviously, the Reading game.
I think we're unbeaten in 11.
One loss in 11. Yeah, that's it. That's insane.
But it's all well and good, but you know, home advantage hasn't counted for anything, right. And this is the one time we need home advantage to really count for us.
Hopefully, Blackburn's getting put on lockdown again, aren't they? So hopefully the whole fucking...
Abandon the game, gives 3 points.
Not going to happen.
Well, let's talk about the whole game then. It was quite nervy, I thought. Well, I was quite nervous. This is like the first time I've really felt the nerves up until kickoff.
It was reverse, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was weird.
I don't know. I just felt like it was the biggest game of our season, obviously. And probably one of the biggest games in our recent history.
Realistically, it is for now.
If we stay up, it could be recent history.
Okay. I'll go with that. Go for it. If we stay up, it'll be an amazing end of the season.
If we stay, like we had this conversation earlier, didn't we?
Yeah.
We stay up, we look back on that whole game, we think, like the whole cliche of, it's a 6 point or whatnot.
But it was.
Realistically, it is.
Of course it was.
It's great.
I mean, but Now, there's a slight... I mean, it's a long shot, but Hull could still stay up. It's a long shot.
No chance.
They could.
Hull started a little bit better than us, a bit quicker than us the weekend. Didn't really do... I didn't have a shot on target the whole game, but I never really felt threatened by Hull, no.
You never shot on target?
According to the EFL stats, but we know what they're
like.
What about the header? What about the header in the first half where Sluger put it over?
Look, I don't know. I'm just following what EFL stats said.
That's a free kick, wasn't it? From the free
kick. Okay, producer Jacob put stats in there. There was two on target, either way.
Yeah, yeah.
EFL on iFollow said there was zero the other day.
They're shit, though, no, sorry.
But they weren't great at the weekend. Like, you could look at Hull and probably say how, for a start, different they were to the whole team we played earlier on in the season, and how they're probably one of the worst teams.
But the difference is they've lost, what, six key players? They lost, what, Bowen, Grzycki. I mean, them two players, man, they're mad.
Yeah.
They're probably... Well, look at Bowen. He's obviously Premier League standard. Grzycki could probably still do it in a Prem for, like, a smaller club, maybe, but... You take into consideration, lost obviously their captain, obviously Madison, whatever else, I don't really care about him, but...
They're still a championship squad, though, and I agree with Luke. I agree with Luke, they were terrible. Mm-hmm. They were terrible.
You say they're still a championship squad, are they? I don't
think... That squad we saw on Saturday was not a championship squad for me.
But, you know, they did not play very well.
And
I think everyone at the beginning of the game was nervous. I'd say both teams were nervous. They knew the significance of not winning. And there was a big significance. So maybe everyone was a little bit, I don't know, what's the word, held back from what they were doing. But
I just don't think Hull have ever been looking well in recent weeks. They haven't looked convincing in anything they do.
No, but we said weeks ago they were dropping like a stone. And that's true.
To be honest, it was months ago we said that.
Yeah.
Months. I think we were talking more February time, weren't we? Christmas, February.
So we said it, they've been poor.
Free fall.
But their performance was very poor. And if you read what some of their supporters said about their game, they weren't very complimentary about Luton, you know, but you don't expect them to be.
Where do you read this stuff? You always say this, but every Twitter comment I've read from Hull fans saying that, no, Luton smashed us.
I just go on for a little look on their message boards.
Oh, message boards, that's so old-fashioned. Go on Twitter.
He's old school, mate.
Come
He's
on, message boards.
Nah, keep it retro, Twitter, mate. Yeah, keep it retro, baby. Come on.
I didn't see one whole fan say that they were better than us at the weekend. No, we didn't deserve to win.
No, I didn't say that. I said that Hull supporters didn't think Luton were a good team. They didn't say they didn't play well. They're annoyed that they lost to Luton, just little old Luton. They're annoyed because they see themselves as a bigger ex-Premier League club, don't they? You know, despite the fact that, you know, we've beaten them on several occasions.
And they haven't got any fans as well, but we'll stick with that.
So I wasn't saying they were saying that Luton didn't play well. I mean, they all acknowledge that Hull City played terribly.
Yeah.
But they didn't expect to lose. This was the game they needed to win. This is the game they thought they could win. And then they didn't.
I don't think they thought they could win it.
Well, I think
not one Hull fan I saw online again on Twitter. I didn't see any Hull fans going, we're going to beat Luton.
I'm sure they would have had a glimmer of hope in there, like we did, was sitting there going, oh, we've got to win this. I'm sure.
Yeah, they probably sat there and thought that. After they lost 8-0 to Wigan, and what we had drawn with QPR, we had Hull fans commenting on our Twitter feed saying, like, oh, you know, easy 3 points for you lot on Saturday. Because they know their team at the moment are not performing.
No. It's hardly surprising, though. Like I said, they've lost a lot of players, and you say, like, obviously, two main players that went, obviously, for transfer fees. But, like I said, what happened after post-COVID, when I think it was, like I said, four or five players left, they were key players for them as well. At least three or four of them were key. So you're talking half their squad have gone from the start of the season.
Yeah.
And that's a major... Do you know what, though? I don't care. No one else cares. I don't give a fuck.
No.
Good. Because if it keeps us up,
who cares?
We don't care. We'd rather them have the high. We've had it before, so let's go. Let's keep going. Let's go to Wednesday. Come on.
We did have a good second half, didn't we? It was second half filled with chances.
Yeah, we started really well second half, really quick. I think we upped the tempo a bit, didn't we?
Massively, yeah.
Yeah, and it showed. And they
but we
couldn't
had to get the
that.
Goal, didn't we?
Yeah. But so did Hull. But, you know, at the end of the day, we were quicker at it. We created more chances second half than you.
We looked more creative, like you said. Yeah. We did. We looked like a team that were going to go on and take a chance and split them. We split them apart. I counted two or three times previous to the goal that we scored. And I think it was Moncur that went through. It was Hilton.
Ray had that header.
Right. Oh, that was the first one, wasn't it? Shit.
The thing is, when you get all those sort of chances in a game, you suddenly think, oh, we're not going to get that one that's going to go in.
Yeah.
And well, the one for me was the Moncur one. That was a chance where I was like, that needs to be scored. He needs to tuck. He needed to either pass that to Pelle or bang that in. And he's just rolled it into the keeper's arms.
Either way, he's got to do a lot better.
He's got to do something with it. Right. And I thought I fell to the floor. I was like, that's it. That was the chance.
You were on the floor, actually. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, in all fairness, though, like, what I would say is that wasn't even the funniest thing. The funniest thing you did on Saturday was the fact that you looked like a shaking little girl. You saw the goal went in because we had the
before I follow.
We had the delay on I follow, right? And no word of a lie, you see this, Dave, you remember this?
Yeah.
And no word of a lie, we're standing up, we're sitting there going, and you've looked at us and you've got like this. This is his face. You go, I'm like, you're all right, Gregory. What's going on, mate? And he's like, I think we scored. That's the whole thing. That's what I remember.
Yeah, it's true.
And I was sitting there going, don't you fucking piss me? Don't do this. It's not funny. He went, no, I'm sorry. I think we scored. Next week, it's gone in. And it's a free
bottom corner.
It's a free from the kitchen.
It's exact kitchen right here on that screen. Beautiful.
Do you know what it was? When Moncur missed that chance, I was so angry. I was like, I'm going to go on Twitter and see what everything else is saying.
And next week.
And I logged on and I just saw like loads of Luton fans tweeting about a goal. And I was like, okay. So I went on Sky Sports, it said whole nil Luton won. And I clicked on it and it said 0-0. And I was like, have we scored? And in here, like you said.
It doesn't matter.
Look up, Kaz comes on and just...
What a goal.
I don't say smashes it bottom corner, smashes it just at the goal. And the keeper's like...
I'm going to be controversial. The keeper should have saved it.
The keeper could have.
I don't care.
No, the keeper could have saved it. But when you see where that move started from, it was just inside the whole half. Mm-hmm. He picked the ball up from, was it from Pelle?
Carter Vickers,
okay. And he wasn't, but he had a free run to the in part of the midfield. The whole defence wasn't there. Then he did the little crossover that sold the dummy and put one in. And really it was a good strike, but it wasn't a brilliant strike.
No, it wasn't.
And the goalkeeper must have been unsighted. He was on the edge of his 6-yard box.
I feel like we just took advantage of
but we deserved that goal.
Real lax defending.
Oh yeah, if that was us conceding that.
Yeah. Yeah. I tell you, we could see the goal like that.
You'd be mental.
This table wouldn't be here. And I think we all, to be honest, I don't think it should be me, would it? I think we'd all just...
We'd all just throw the table out there?
I think we'd just get the table and just launch it at the bottom of the garden somewhere. Just to feel like a man again.
I feel like that goal we scored against them is the type of goal they're so used to seeing where they just feel like they're defenders. There's just no closing down. There was no tracking. And the fact that it's just gone just shoot.
Well, the body language after it went in from them was just typical, you know. Yeah. Typical.
I don't care.
I literally don't care. No Luton fan would care that they're bothered because you know we got what we could have got more goals as well, but we got the result that we deserved out of that game. Totally.
Isn't it great just having a player like Luwalua back in the team? Like his last that when he came on against Huddersfield, I just felt like he was the perfect player you want when you're trying to run down that clock. He's so good at shooting.
I'm sure. Obviously, we were saying screaming for Luwalua to get on the pitch, weren't we? I think we were saying Luwalua, McManaman, like I say, straight.
Got down the end.
Yeah, that's what I mean. But I'm sure that, what, another 10, 15,000 Luton fans were screaming for the same thing. I'm sure of it.
Yeah, but the manager made the change. He did make the change.
We needed a bit of pace. We needed a bit of clock. Do you know what? He looked like a Brazil player the other day. He did. The amount of turns he was doing, back towards the player and just doing it all. Out in the corner flag in the second half, late on, I think he took on their left back or whatever.
Yeah, when he cut in. When Moncur had that chance to make it two.
But he genuinely, when he came on, he changed the pace of the game. Genuinely, that's great. It was brilliant, and it was good to see. And you're right. When he gets the ball, and you think, oh, he's very strong at running that ball to the corner and out the right.
His left foot, his right foot, he's both.
Did you expect him to shoot when he shot and go? No, he was way out. Was he 28 yards out?
Wide or whatever.
28 yards out, 25, 30. It's one of those, if he shoots and it doesn't go in, you go, what have you done that for? Mm-hmm. But I think
he's done that a few times, though, Kaz, this season.
I think, you know, when he came on, he was a star, absolute star.
Do you know how many times I've seen him do that at Brighton? I'm sure you probably remember a few years back, he's at Brighton. Matt Tully used to come on as a super sub, and he used to impact the game. And I remember, Brighton, there was always a thing about Brighton, was saying how Luwalua came on and always used to be a game changer for them. And I don't know about single-handedly getting them promoted or something, but he helped them largely. And you see what he does. And I tell you what, if we start this season, then you've got to look back on some of the things he's done as well.
Luolo, I did have the most dribbles in the 30 minutes he was on the pitch than any other player. Yeah. Six dribbles. Yeah. I know in recent weeks we've spoken about, like, I've spoken about how I feel Cornick is very one-dimensional and stuff. And I just feel like you compare the type of play. I know you can do that. But you compare their two styles of play and just how unpredictable Luolo is compared to someone. That's all I feel. But
no, I understand.
I think
that,
having both of them start against Blackburn, either wing with Colo centre, could be good.
See, I know this might not go down well, but I don't want Luar to start. I want him to be on the bench. I want him on the bench again, because I tell you what, if we need that goal, and Luar's...
It's different, isn't it?
Yeah. If Luar's been playing from the first minute to whenever, he's not going to last a full 90 at that pace. He'll give you probably a half like that. He won't give you 2 hours. That's how I personally feel. And I think if we can just maybe, you know, hold it quite tight in the first... I'll simply answer it, but hold, you know, Blackburn to not many chances and just try and dictate the pace of the game a little bit. Mm-hmm. If we can bring Luolo on last sort of 35 minutes, if we need a goal, then I think we need him on the bench for that game-changing... I mean, you can put... to finish games, put anyone on. You can start how we did the other day. I'm happy with that same squad starting again. I'm happy with that.
I'm hopeful that we don't need that goal because we've got two or three up already. That's what you want it to be. But it's never going to be that, is it? It's never going to be easy because, you know, it wouldn't be Luton Town if it was that easy.
You're saying potentially they might be playing a few of their...
Yeah, I read online that apparently Blackburn are going to give a few of their youngsters a run out, which could benefit us.
Hopefully
benefit us.
Unless they have like absolute storms and then they're worth like £10 million the game after. Yeah. Do you know what I mean?
So, how annoying. How annoying.
But it's come down to this really, hasn't it? One more game. If at the start of the season you would have said it's going to go down to that final game of the season where a win would keep you up, a draw might keep you up, and a loss still could keep you up, I think you'd have snapped anyone's hand off for that.
I think everyone told you that, you think they're a fucking idiot. I think that's what you'd probably say, they're crazy. Because I would never believe this, you would never believe this, you would never believe this, Dave. I'm sure none of you lot would have believed this.
The stages from the season where I wouldn't have 100% wouldn't have
believed it. I mean, we were adrift for a while.
I think at one point it was about 9 points off, weren't we? So, 7 or 8 points, maybe.
And Nathan Jones has got the team going. Mm. And, you know, despite what people may think or have thought about him coming back, he's got the team going. And, you know, this one last push gets him over the line and you have a tattoo and everybody loves him.
One of the things I said to you earlier, Batara, about Jones is that if you notice most of his teams at the moment, they're all players he knows and all players he's worked with in the past. Yeah. Even like Carl Vickers, he worked with him at Stoke. And there's a couple of exceptions, obviously, with like Bree and Sluger. But there's like no Tunney at the moment, there's no Butterfield, you know.
Maybe you know something that a few of us knew about work rate, for example, coming into it. Because, I mean, you know, Butterfield, he's called Butterbean then. Butterfield got, he got slightly quite a bit for his work rate. So I know you picked up on it a few times. I think
Jones, or Graham Jones, always alluded to Butterfield not closing down quick enough.
Sorry, it was Graham Jones. Yeah. Yeah. Also said it, yeah.
But Nathan Jones is a motivator, and you can't get it away from them. He's definitely motivated this team. They definitely seem happier, and they just need one last bit of motivation to get us over that line.
And if I tell you what, and we stay out, that would be motivating us to go on a 5-day bender. Well, me anyway, I don't know you, because I'm still furloughed, so I'm loving it.
I'll join you.
I'm telling you, if we stay up, I can't wait to accompany you to the tattoo studio. I can't wait.
It's going to be good.
Might have to get a little family page going, because it might cost a bit.
Well, we wanted to look at James Bree as a player focus because we've been really impressed with him since post-COVID, really. So I think under Nathan Jones, he's just blossomed into like a really nice right back.
It's a really nice flower. It was so lovely now.
What have you thought of him, though?
I think he's been class, mate. Do you know what? I feel really bad now because I'm not even going to sit and hide behind it, but I used to sit there and say to you all, I'm sure...
Mate, we've all slated him on this podcast before.
Because I didn't think he was good enough to be even in a struggling Luton side at some points. Sometimes I used to see him have good games. I mean, he did it right against Barnsley. I remember the first sort of like part of the season, whatever, beat Barnsley away 3-1. He did it right there. I remember looking at him going, why can't you do that on a consistent basis? Don't get me wrong, it was only early, but...
Surely that's a coaching influence, isn't it? Surely, maybe, I don't know. Yeah, because you don't suddenly become a crap player, do you?
Maybe he's a different kind of right back that needs coach. Like I said to you earlier about balance. You need balance sometimes, certain players, and certain players will not, like you say, use the word blossom. They will not blossom unless they have the right players around them. I've always gone, do you know what? Love Football Manager, love it all.
I just think it helps when you have a manager that just can maybe give you that bit of confidence, that bit of self-belief.
And also the team.
Yeah, but you could, I know we've spoken about this before, but it just comes with anything in life. If someone's telling you that you're good and they're really happy with that, gets your confidence up. It improves your mental performance. And I'm sure it would in football games as well.
The time I was good, I probably tried to do a step over before I broke my neck or something, but that's fine. But yeah, I know what you're saying. As a professional footballer, you're probably right. You do need maybe a
boost
over the shoulder.
And he's done that, hasn't he? And he's told him that to get better, he needs to do something, and he's done it.
Some players react different to certain, mentalities and philosophies and whatnot. Whereas maybe Graham Jones, he didn't really get on with Graham Jones, or didn't really, like I say, flourish under him because a certain way of what he was being told, he didn't like that. And maybe Jones got, maybe, but like I always say, like certain players will not always be the same.
No.
Certain players will not need a hand round them and saying, like, come on, boy. Some players might want him to, because I know for a fact, I want someone telling him, like, do you know what I mean?
Don't you think, though, recently, the energy levels of all the players have been different? The energy levels have been different. Like, they want to play.
At times.
And that has helped Bree stand out.
At times, though. I've still not really been impressed in a few games.
But it's, let's be honest, the first three quarters of the season, we had some shocking performances.
Yeah, I can name three or four.
Yeah, exactly. And we were at
really
them,
bad.
You know, we were at them.
Races.
And you go, I think Bree has definitely got better. And he's definitely playing a lot better than he did at the sort of mid through the season.
I think if you look at our away form post-COVID, it's been unreal. And I don't think you can fault energy levels in them games. I think in the home games, that Reading game, I thought we looked very tired. Very tired. And to be honest, I felt we looked tired in the second half of the Barnsley game. The QPR goal, still ain't seen that because you pulled the plug out the computer when we were trying to watch that. But
sorry about that.
It's, it's just one of the things where we need now... Wednesday night, everyone just needs to be fully energised
and
ready to go.
And you need James Bree to play the best he can play.
And I think every single fan needs to be stoned because you ain't going to be able to do that on a calm one. No way.
Would you take him on a permanent if it was possible at the end of the season, on a free?
Well, if he can play like he's doing at the moment, then definitely, mate, yeah.
Well, yeah, why not? Why not take a gamble on
him? Like I always said to you boys, well, I said to a few other people as well, I said, Villa paid good money for him a few years back from Barnsley, I believe it was.
Yeah.
Why did they pay that money? Because I even myself be guilty of this a few times. I know a lot of people have said it and they've gone, why have they taken a chance on him? Like he looks shite and whatever. And I started to instead of a Luton player, you don't get on him too much, but I did question how he'd got to.
Well, they saw some potential in him, didn't they? And it depends on where Villa will be next season. Mm. You know, Villa are still I think so. Yeah, I think so.
To be honest, I think we can get him cheaper than what they pay for him. So
I think if Villa
go down,
there's no way Bree's getting in that starting 11.
No way in a million years. No way.
In which case, then he'll stay with us, won't he?
I think so. Or he might go back to Ipswich, never know.
Yeah.
That's how bad his last game is. No, I'm joking. But no, seriously, we need to kick on now. I'm hoping that Bree... Do you know what would be great? If Sluger saves a penalty late on and Bree scores the winner.
Why do you make it so hard? Stop it.
I love a fantasy.
Don't have one of those. Have a fantasy of a 9-0 win then. And stop making it so
hard. I will when I'm dreaming tonight.
I want bloody Sluger to save a penalty and get a last minute. I don't want that heart attack.
No, I want
to be 5-0 up at half bloody time.
What do you think I want that? No, I don't want that.
5-0 up.
Imagine the scenes.
Stop it. 5-0 up at half time. I'm booking your appointment. No, I don't want to get stressed. Stop going for the worst scenario, man.
Either way, I think it's going to be a messy game on Wednesday. Nerves are going to be high. If they get a penalty first, I don't think I'll be able to take it. Let's put it that way. Lewis says, I feel like Bree and Stacey are similar. Stacey's obviously a bit better, but if Bree carries on what he's doing, there's nothing stopping him to try and get on the same level as Stacey. I think they are two different players.
Yeah, I don't know if I think about Stacey. I don't know if I put Stacey and Bree in the same category somehow.
No, I'd agree, like
I said, I'm not going to obviously par him off, but like it's, I know what you're saying, like maybe he needs a confidence boost and he might blossom into
into maybe a Stacey, potentially.
Why can't he become as good as Stacey?
Because of different players, for a start.
For me, Stacey, I don't know. I've never seen a player like Stacey at right back in my life, I don't think.
No, not he's mad. Anyway. He's mad. Simon says, good choice on the player focus today. He's been dynamite and totally undroppable since lockdown. Nothing like his twin brother who played for us during the first half of the season. That poor side was severely lacking in confidence and didn't look like he was comfortable on the pitch at times. Which is what we said, isn't it? It does look like he's more confident on the ball now and in the back four.
I love the way I said poor sod as well, because sometimes I think we have to remember they are actually humans as well.
Yeah, and you just need the right direction. Yeah. You need the right coach and you need the right person boosting you up.
That's what I've started to realise as well.
Clearly, he didn't have that at the beginning of the season. We just said that.
We spoke last week about when Cornick missed that chance against Barnsley and some of the stick that we saw him getting on Twitter. And like, it's just the thing, you do forget sometimes that these people do go home, they do look at their social media. And Bree's probably had a lot, probably including us as well. I'm not going to say we're perfect, but
you got to be. You can criticise. When I play, the thing is, right, on the other flip side now, you can also criticise. If you're paying good money to watch your team and they're not performing how you know they should be performing, you can't criticise because you're entitled to that opinion because you pay your good money. But like you said, they're not robots, they are human. We understand they make mistakes in life. Like, anyone makes mistakes. And also, I know people going about, obviously, I said about Nathan Jones. Make mistake at 43 years of age, and you know, whatever. But like I said, everyone makes mistakes. Everyone says things and whatnot. But you've got to remember, they're not robots.
Yeah, but you shouldn't be abusive. No. You can make your comments, and you're entitled to make your comments. And this is why we're here, isn't it?
I'm sure coaches do as well. Yeah,
exactly.
I'm sure coaches do as well.
But this is why we're doing this, right? Because we want to talk about the football. And you have every right to talk about a player and say he's bad or he's good or he's brilliant or not so great. And that's what this whole thing is about. That's why you love football, right? So, have an opinion, but don't be abusive with it.
Yeah, this is it, yeah.
Barney says, completely different player under Nathan Jones. Pre-lockdown, I was texting a Villa supporter, who was a friend, saying, please take him back. Now I'm saying, can we keep him? Looks to have so much more freedom down the wing. Reckon we should sign him up if we can. Anthony says he's a different player under Nathan Jones. If we stay up, we should try and tie him down. Chris says, it seems as though Nathan Jones has got the best out of him. Seems a different player, solid defensively and gets forward like the fullbacks we're used to. And Steve thinks we should invest with him in the future, for sure. And Callum says, before Nathan Jones came back, I would say it's terrible, but fair play to him. He's different gravy. Try everything to keep him, even if it's another loan deal.
It's mad, I think it's Jones, yeah.
And all those comments have one familiar thing in them, Nathan Jones. Four comments, 1, 2, 3, 4. Everyone says Nathan Jones has got the best out of him. Maybe Nathan Jones is the man to get this guy to come back to our club.
Potentially, yeah. You see it.
Nice to see Kiosa get on the pitch the other day, actually.
Yeah, it was. Debut as well.
A minute, if that.
I love his status. What is it? Debut onto Wednesday. We're going to stay up. Faith in God. And that's what I was like. Go on, boy. You have it, mate. Go on. You tell him. I loved it. But no, look. I'm just sitting there now. I'm feeling all kinds of things right now because I'm just thinking about Wednesday. I think we're all sitting there thinking about Wednesday because this is when it comes down to it. We can sit here and talk and whatever we do.
Yeah.
But we're not in control.
So let's get into some Instagram questions to end today's podcast, last 10 minutes. Tom says, if we stay up, what area do you think we should strengthen in the transfer window?
Well, I'll let you think. Tommy Earlybrooks, striker.
I think we would probably need another striker.
Yeah, I think we need one striker. Yeah, we can keep.
We need two strikers.
Do you know what? You could strengthen everywhere in the team. It's another player that comes in to help the squad and strength. Yeah. So, it's difficult. Would you stay with the same back four, for instance? No, because you know Carter Vickers isn't going to come back, is he? Unless we can sign him permanently, is that going to happen?
I doubt it.
No, so you need to. You just need to think. The whole team needs strengthening.
I think you'd be really disappointed if we stayed up and went into next season with hardly any like new players in the team. I think you'd want the freshness. I feel like we do need to get rid of the deadwood.
So yeah, get rid of the deadwood. But the thing is, normally at the end of a season, and let's be honest, it's a strange end to a season because there are players that are out of contract already. And I would say normally you go, we might lose him. Well, do you know what? This season we might lose Collins.
But the way I look at it is, if whoever we lose, I just trust in whoever we got. Well, obviously, Nathan, we know what Nathan's like. We've trusted him before and he's obviously done a job.
Don't get him in.
And he'll sort it out. Yeah.
If they're not already working on it, I'll be surprised.
100%. Yeah. Definitely working it.
So I think they'll strengthen each area of the team. That's what I feel.
But yeah, I for me, the most important position that we need to strengthen next season, I feel like we need a proper midfielder, Don't take the wrong way, though, obviously, about certain players we've got, but I feel like we need someone to take control. Someone who's got, you know, like someone who's going to bully people and win that ball back. And they can pass the ball as well. Mm-hmm. Not just do one, we need like an all-rounded, like a, what we thought Tony Cliff would kind of be.
Hmm.
Not being horrible to Tony Cliff, but you know he might fit in better with certain different players. But and also a centre half.
I guess that
centre half.
I guess that kind of links into Rob's question of he's asked us to break down the squad, keep, sell or loan.
Jesus.
We won't go too in depth in it. But if you had to say like some of the players you think should go, or we should sell, because I'm looking at like. I said earlier, I love Danny Huon, right?
I just feel
if we stay up, I just think we need to let go of the past and just try and get some new, fresh, young legs
if
in.
Danny can stay fit and if he's...
If he can do a job...
If he's happy he's to not stay and not be guaranteed first team
but
football,
that's the problem,
would,
isn't it?
100% I would keep him.
Because he's different. I don't see him now at the moment as a guaranteed start.
No.
But especially with strength so much. As
well. But then... Who else do you put in? They must be looking. I think Danny Hilton's been great at the club.
But I still believe that he could do a job.
Even when he came, on
Wednesday,
Saturday. He had a couple of chances.
Yeah,
and he knows how to hold the ball up, so he's a workhorse like that. Mm. But you know, so
if
I think
we stay up,
so much more to his game as well. But yeah,
could you see Chiosa going out on loan?
No, I think if we stay up,
maybe
for a season, but then. It depends if you keep Bree, like we say, you know, it depends who you've got at that position. But for me, Chiosa can still do a job at right back as a replacement. Don't get me wrong, like I said, I've seen him play before, but I've never seen him play in a championship.
We need to build a squad that's going to stay up comfortably next season.
Yes, but we definitely need a new centre-half.
Yeah.
For me, not being able to Pearson, but I don't believe he's got what it takes to...
I'll take any squad that keeps us in mid-table next year.
Yeah, or even above relegation by this comfortable position.
Mid-table, please.
Yeah.
And then we listen, and then we push on. That's the main mission.
Chaz says, since Cardiff on the 8th of February, we've won 6, drawn 6 and lost 2, which is playoff form, what do you think made the difference? And I know the other week you said we kind of got to give some credit to Graham Jones because he went on that 4-5 match run where things started to look a bit better. What do you reckon did? Obviously, you could look at this.
I think for me, I've looked at this. I still feel as if we had players last season. players last season when the pressure was on, they came through and they performed. I feel like more of them players are back in now, and they're performing under pressure again, but in a different circumstance. That's what I'm feeling at the moment.
I think the pressure is entirely different this season.
Mm-hmm.
Entirely different.
But at the same time, you still need to get points. You still need to get points on board to get to that
line.
I agree with that. But what I would ask you, Dave, is there a difference from getting points to get to the line to win a trophy, to win a title, like we did last season, or is it compared to getting points to get over the line and finish outside their relegation play? Is there much difference for that? Because I don't feel there is. Apart from maybe confidence... Maybe slightly.
The confidence last season was there to be seen,
mm-hmm.
and sometimes this season I think we haven't had it. We haven't had that mm-hmm. confidence. Has it? What was the question? Is it changed? What has changed? What is the change? It's new motivation, new manager. That's what I feel, and belief in themselves maybe that they didn't have before.
Maybe yeah.
And that, but when last season they believed they could win every game. This season they've gone out, maybe not in that same frame of mind.
It was a different mentality. I all agree that it was a different mentality under Graham Jones.
Yeah, so the pressure is there, isn't it? The pressure is there for either end of the table. Mid-table doesn't matter, does it? But either end. But the consequences of one over the other... You know,
if we stay up, would you look at lockdown and the four-month break we had from football as maybe a bit of a positive?
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's a mini season, isn't
definitely.
It? It's just turned into a mini season, and we
because form for certain teams is now not a thing as well. You see it all change around now. The form guide is massive.
Yeah.
Apart from Wigan, like that's his free.
Yeah, and you've only got to look at the top of the table for that as well, haven't you? You know, the top of the table changed significantly for that other club that you work with, and
brilliant.
Yeah, and it has.
I think when you look at when we came back out of lockdown, I was quite surprised Luton didn't play more friendlies, because Brentford did play for Brentford. We played two friendlies.
Stop saying we. You support Luton. Stop saying fucking we.
I thought that Luton would have played more friendlies.
Yeah.
Well, maybe they just couldn't arrange any.
Plenty of teams out there could have arranged some friendlies against.
But at the same time, though, maybe a different thing in place. Maybe to get to know the players a bit better. Maybe do some, team exercises that he wanted to do.
Yeah.
Don't know what they were doing. But what I would say is that, the performances have been brilliant post lockdown, apart from that.
Some home ones
Could have been better. But performance, well, let's put form has been good. So, yeah, we've had a mini league since lockdown. So, brilliant. Well, thank you, lockdown.
Yeah, exactly. Do you know what, right?
Would the manager would have still changed, I think? They would have still brought the new guy in. I think they would have been talking about that. They must have known that Graham Jones wasn't doing it right. And so, yeah, fantastic. It's just, we had that break. We got refreshed. So they had a time to recharge. And maybe that's why they're playing better.
But one thing I look back on, right, as well, is obviously we went literally, I think it was the week or 2 weeks before the whole lockdown thing got imposed and whatever on Britain. But we went to Manchester, didn't we, for the Wigan game?
Yeah.
And obviously we went for a night out, I think.
Good weekend.
Yeah, I think that was the last game that we got to see, wasn't it, before obviously it all happened. And I'll never forget, I sat there and we were sitting there bitching at anything, sitting there going, fucking hate that. That game was awful, terrible.
It was terrible.
Oh, fucking. Oh, really, we need to be beating teams like Wigan. We're going to stay up. Well, we're not going to stay up. It was a bit like that for a while, do you know what I mean? And you look back on it now and you think,
what good point that was.
Shit, that's a great point.
Considering they looked awful that day as well. They didn't look good.
Maybe it's what they do to teams, though. They make teams look awful because they play like in a certain way where they're so flat, do you know what I mean? They play like such a flat fucking formation. You can see it. We were quite high up, we can see it. They don't take risks. They don't concede goals. So they can score a goal from a set piece, we'll get up, apart from scoring 8 against Hull, but you know what I mean?
Turned out to be a good point, though.
Yeah, it did. In the end, it did. Yeah.
Let's rattle through the last few Instagram questions then, quick answers to these. So Zach says, who's your player of the season so far?
Player of the season?
There's one more game. Who's your player of the season?
Oh.
One answer, just say a name.
I don't know. Is the answer I'll give it.
Player of the season,
Can you come back to me after?
I'll come back to you next week if you want. I want it now.
Come back to us next week.
I'm going to say Pelly Ruddock. Grace says, are you confident for Wednesday?
Yeah, of course I am. Yeah. Fuck it, let's go. Yeah, let's have it. Of course we
are. Are you confident for Wednesday?
Confident or just buzzing for my tits? Yeah, either way.
Brilliant.
I don't know what it is.
I'll be more confident when we stick the first goal in.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
provided we score first.
All we really have time for today, though.
Play of the season, though. Oh, it's a tough one.
Have a think. We'll put this on Twitter. Who's your player of the season so far? I think that's... we might ask you after Wednesday. We'll wait for Wednesday.
Ooh, shame you didn't ask next question.
Yeah.
I would say Carl Vickers, he's been there all season, but... Is that a bad thing if I say Carl Vickers?
Cause
I think
not really.
A massive difference.
Not really.
I think he's been key to our turning form. He has.
Well, that's all we've got time for. Thanks so much for listening and watching. True. As always, if you're watching on YouTube, go grab the audio version, search us on your podcast app. If you're listening on the podcast app, search us on YouTube. And get us on social media, over in the town. We shall see you next week for a...
We'll see you Wednesday afterwards. I tell you what, if we're staying up, mate. I tell you what, either way, there will be a camera set up. I'm setting up a camera. You're not doing it. I'm doing it. And the celebration will be live for you all to see. I'm not even live. It's a 5-minute delay. It's happening. And if not... Put it this way.
Has he been drinking?
No. Sorted. Yeah. Have a good one. And we'll just see you sometime next week.
Special Wednesday.
Have a good one.